People of God, look around you and see the faces of those people that you know and love, a community of kindred hearts. Look around you and see the faces of people that you hardly know, strangers, sojourners, forgotten friends, folks perhaps that need an outstretched hand. Look around and see the images of God in me and you and all the people of the world. God's Spirit is open and shining for all of us to see. So as we worship this morning, may our eyes, our hearts, and our souls also be open as we join together in our call to worship. We are here because we have collected the hurts and hatreds of living through yet another week.
We gather as a wounded people.
We are here because we have also seen joy and hope and creativity, new life in the week that we've just lived through.
We gather as the wandering people.
We are here because we believe that Christ is the true power that brings life together and makes it whole.
We gather as the worshiping people.
We begin a new week as we celebrate resurrection, Christ's victory over death, our victory over despair and hopelessness.
We gather not to relive the past, but to be renewed that we might build the future.
Let us pray. Creating and redeeming God, calling and sending Spirit, we welcome you into our worship this morning and pray that you would hope in our hearts to receive you into our worship. We welcome the love that is the very essence of your nature. We receive the word and the sacraments that mediate your grace. We welcome the one who is new to us, the one who is hurting, the one who is sad or lonely. We welcome the old and the young, the healthy, the infirm, the strong and the weak, for we all have been or will be each of these in our own turn. We receive your gifts and your blessings with profound gratitude, so envelop us now in the mystery of your presence, we pray, as we seek to worship you in spirit and truth. For it is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
So never say it's unfair. Confidence is not there. And everything I know is everything I've sown. So Father, give me freedom, providence and wisdom, for when I am alone, when I am alone. Guess you caught me dreaming. All of your deceiving was water to my soul. Underneath it all, I've never really known how all of this would work out. With nowhere left to go, nowhere left to go. So say it's unfair, confidence is not there, for everything I know is everything I've sown. So Father, give me freedom, providence and wisdom, for when I am alone, when I am alone. Sound.
If you're like me, you grew up around an awful lot of old wives' tales or old spouses' tales, as it were. We came up around our grandmothers and our grandfathers, and they were always imparting their wisdom to us. You know, things like, well, you know, if you pick it, it won't get better. You know, we always heard that. Cleanliness is next to godliness, you know, that kind of thing. Or my mama always carried a rag on her apron, and she'd come, come here, let me clean your nose. And she'd take that, and then she'd go wash dishes, you know. You know, we always get those kind of, old wives' tales, and, you know, I collected a few of them I wanted to share with you this morning. I always heard growing up that bleach was the very best cleaner you could use for your bathroom. My mother's bathroom always smelled like bleach. I mean, you walk in there and your eyes start burning, you know. She always believed that bleach was the very best cleaner, but it isn't. In fact, to be quite honest with you, bleach doesn't really clean anything. About the only thing bleach does, it disinfects. So you have to clean whatever it is first, and then use the bleach to disinfect. There's also that old wives' tale about too much vacuuming can ruin your carpets. Now, in my own estimation, I think that rumor was started by somebody that really didn't want to vacuum. But the truth of the matter is that if you don't vacuum your carpet, then what that does is it allows all those dirt particles to sink deeper and deeper into the carpet and eventually winds up doing a lot more damage, you see, to the carpet than actually vacuuming. I've heard or was told that washing dishes by hand was a lot more effective than using a dishwasher. My grandmother had a dishwasher. She never used it. 30 years she had it sitting in her kitchen. She never used it, because she just didn't believe any newfangled device like a dishwasher would work. Hand washing was always better. Well, the truth of the matter is that when you wash dishes in a dishwasher, you wash them at a much higher temperature. If you have a drying cycle, it dries at a very high temperature, which virtually means that there are no germs. They come out sanitized. And one of my favorites, my mother taught us how to iron clothes and how to wash clothes, but that old wives' tale about washing clothes in cold water doesn't get them clean. We were always told that. I can remember my mama washing clothes, and you'd open the lid on that washer, and the steam just poured out. It was like 3 degrees short of being boiling, you know, in all the clothes. And we never could figure out why our clothes were all kind of gray. Whatever color they were gone. Well, the truth is that cold water is actually much better in the long run for clothes, because it helps preserve the quality of the fabric. It also helps to preserve the color that's in there. And it also saves money and energy. And so it really is a sort of a win-win all around. In a lot of our lives, there are a lot of old wives' tales, a lot of myths that we adhere to that we believe, whether there's any truth to them or not. And one of those myths is the fact that, well, if we just attend church and sit in and listen to the preacher and learn all the creeds and whatnot, then that makes us righteous people. And really nothing scripturally could be further from the truth. Just simply occupying that little old 2-foot space that you're sitting in this morning, that just doesn't do the trick. There's only one thing that really washes us clean, and that is the spirit of repentance, the spirit of confession. The scriptures tell us that when we confess our sins, that he is righteous and just to forgive us. And so let us take advantage now of that cleansing power by confessing our sins before God and before each other. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The hatred which divides nation from nation, race from race, class from class, Father, forgive. The covetous desires of people and nations to possess what is not their own, Father, forgive. The greed that exploits the work of human hands, lays waste to the earth, Father, forgive. Our envy of the welfare and happiness of others, Father, forgive. Our indifference to the plight of the imprisoned, the homeless, the refugee, Father, forgive. The lust which dishonors the bodies of men, women, children, Father, forgive. The pride which leads us to trust in ourselves and not in God, Father, forgive. Let us be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven us. My children, this morning, know that each of you are loved, that each of you are forgiven, that each of you are redeemed because you are the Lord's. So this morning, take advantage of the grace of God. Be renewed in your faith. For in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we who are your people come to you this morning fully aware that we need your presence and we need your help in our life. And yet at the same time, we're aware that we often fail to stop and turn to you for that very help. We get all caught up in all the troubles, all the turmoil of living from day to day. We get busy trying to meet the goals that we have set for ourselves or that have come down to us from the place that we work or have been given to us by our family and our friends. We really do strive to be loving and to seek joy and peace and to be gentle and patient and kind, to show goodness, have self-control, all those good things. And yet, those very good things all too often elude us. Lord, help us to root ourselves deeply in you, to seek your will for our lives, to stop and listen for your voice in those times when we're troubled, to fully rely on you when we strive to do that thing that is right, to remember you and trust in you when we are assaulted, to meditate on your goodness and your gracious will when we begin every day, so that like those trees that are planted by the streams of water, that our roots would be placed deep into the earth so that we can produce the fruit that is the power of your Spirit. Lord, we ask that you would hear your children as they pray this morning. We offer prayers for all of those who are lonely, those who are fearful or in pain, those who are struggling with addiction or dependencies that cripple their lives, that harm the relationships. We remember the concerns and the prayers that are lifted up by all the members of this congregation and community, those that we speak with our lips, those that reside heavily upon our hearts, concerns and prayers that we lift up with them. Lord, thank you for being our God and for making us your people. Thank you for growing in us and helping us to grow. Thank you for the ministry that you entrust to us, and may your will be done in us and by us. So as we seek to walk that path that goes to your Son, our Lord, who taught us how to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And grace my fears.
Journeying through the scriptures this morning, our first stop is the book of Hebrews. This morning we will be reading from chapter 11. Heed these words. The fundamental fact of existence is that this trust in God, this faith, is the firm foundation under everything that makes life worth living. It's our handle on what we can't see. This act of faith is what distinguished our ancestors and set them apart from the crowd. By faith, we see the world called into existence by God's word, what we see created by what we don't see. By an act of faith, Abraham said yes to God's call to travel to an unknown place that would be his home. And when he left, he had no idea where he was going. By an act of faith, he lived in that country that God promised him, lived as a stranger, camping in tents. Isaac and Jacob did the same, living under the same promise. Abraham did it by keeping his eye on that unseen city with real eternal foundations, a city that was designed and built by God. By faith, barren Sarah was able to become pregnant, an old woman at the time, because she believed the one who made a promise would do exactly what he said. And that's how it happened that from one man's dead and shriveled loins, there are now people numbering into the millions. Each one of these people of faith died, not yet having seen what was promised, but they still believe. So how'd they do it? Well, they saw it off in the distance, you know, waved their greeting and accepted the fact that they were just transients in this world. Now, people that live like this make it plain that they're looking for their true home. If they were homesick for the old country, then they could have gone back there anytime they wanted to. But you see, these were after a far better country than that. They were after heaven country. So you can see why God is proud of them, and he has a city waiting for them. Our message from the gospel comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verses 32 through 40. Now, what I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax, not to get so preoccupied with getting that you can't respond to God's giving. People that don't know God and the way God works, well, they fuss over stuff like that. But you know who God is, and you know how he works. So steep yourself in this God reality, this God initiative, this God provision, and then you'll find that all your everyday human concerns will be met. Don't be afraid of missing out, because you're my friends and my Father wants to give you the very kingdom itself, so be generous. Give to the poor. Find yourselves a bank that doesn't go bankrupt. One in heaven that's safe from bank robbers, from embezzlers, a bank that you can bank on. It's kind of obvious, isn't it? I mean, the place where your treasure is, well, that's the place that you're going to most want to be, and that's where you're going to wind up. So keep your shirt on, keep the lights on, be like house servants who are waiting for the master to come back from his honeymoon. They're awake and ready to open the door when he arrives and knocks. Now, lucky servants are the ones that the master is going to find on the watch. And when he comes in, he'll put on an apron, he'll sit them down at the table, and he'll serve them a meal. They'll share with him in his wedding feast. It won't make much difference what time of the night he arrives. They're awake, and because of that, they're blessed. Now, you know, if the homeowner had known what time the burglar was going to come, he wouldn't have stayed out late, and he wouldn't have left the place unlocked. So don't be slovenly and don't be careless. Just when you don't expect him, then that's when the Son of Man will show up.
And I saw him in the crowd. A lot of people had gathered round him. The beggar shouted to the lepers, called him. The old man said nothing, he just said about him.
All good in town to see the Lord Jesus. All good in town to see the Lord Jesus. All good in town.
Then came a man, before his feet he fell. Unclean, so the leper rang his bell. felt the palm of a hand touch his head. Go now, go now, you're a new man instead. Oh, go in time. Star took them to Bethlehem and made it heard throughout the land. Born was the leader of men.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we long to see you, we long to know you. But we don't pretend to have all the answers, because truth is, I mean, how could we ever really understand your ways? As we look around at our world today, help us to do so with a sense of humility. Don't let us dismiss the words of the scripture that we've already heard, but instead open our hearts up to brand new words that you're going to speak. We want to be changed by you. We ask that you would use the word today to do that, to challenge us, to teach us, to move us more toward being like your Son, in whose holy name we pray. Amen. The foundation for the sermon this morning is based on this text that comes from the prophecy of Isaiah. Picked it especially because there is so much in this text for this morning that resembles our daily living in our culture today. So this scripture from Isaiah chapter 1, verses 1 and 10 through 20, pay attention. This is the vision that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw regarding Judah and Jerusalem during the time of the kings of Judah, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. Listen to my message, you Sodom school leaders. Receive God's revelation, you Gomorrah school people. Why all these frenzied sacrifices? God's asking, don't you think I've had my fill of burnt sacrifices, all those rams and plump grain-fed calves? Don't you think I've had my fill of blood from bulls and lambs and goats? When you come in front of me, when you come before me, whoever gave you the idea that you could act like this, running here and there, doing this and that, all this sheer commotion in the place that where you're supposed to be worshiping. So quit your worship charades. I can't stand your trivial religious games, monthly conferences, weekly conferences, weekly Sabbaths, special meetings, 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 meetings. I can't stand one more. Meetings for this, meetings for that. I hate them. You've worn me out. I'm sick of your religion, 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 while you just keep right on sinning. When you put on your next prayer performance, I'm going to be looking the other way. Don't make any difference how loud you pray or how often, or I'm not going to be listening. And you know why? Because you've been tearing people to pieces. Your hands are bloody. So go home and wash up, clean up your act, sweep your lives clean of your evil doing so I don't have to look at them anymore. Say no to wrong, learn to do good, work for justice, help the down and out, stand up for the homeless, go to bat for the defenseless. Come and sit down. Let's talk this out. If your sins are blood red, they'll be snow white. If they're red like crimson, they'll be like wool. If you will willingly obey, then you will feast like kings. But if you're willful and stubborn, then you'll die like dogs. That's right. God says so. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Soap, common element in every single household. Really makes no difference how rich or poor you are. Soap is a part of our everyday experience, or at least hopefully it is part of our everyday experience. And soap, in one form or another, has been around for a very, very long time. Thousands of years, in fact. You see, it didn't take humans long to learn that if you take animal fat of some kind, and you mix it with wood ashes and a little bit of water, then amazingly what you get is soap. I remember my granny making soap. She had a big old iron pot out in the backyard, and she would collect all the fat, and she would put lye in it, and they'd cook it down and make soap. And that was the soap that Granny used. She washed dishes with it. She cleaned the bathroom floor with it. And it's the same soap she used to scrub behind your ears. When you got through taking a bath at my granny's, honey, you were cherry red. That layer of skin on the outside, that rascal was gone. You didn't have to worry about things like defoliating, because granny's soap took care of that for you. The earliest evidence that we have of soap production goes back to somewhere around 2800 B.C. That's a long time ago. Archaeologists found a Mesopotamian clay tablet where it talked about soap. In Babylonia, they found another clay tablet where there was a recipe that was there for how to make soap, how to use water and alkali and various oils to make it. That was from about 2200 B.C. And soap is mentioned three times in the Old Testament, once in Job, once in Jeremiah, and once in Malachi. So soap has been a part of how we live as human beings for a long time, and for good reason, for good reason. Granny always said, cleanliness was next to godliness, right? She said that, she meant it. Every mother has, since time immemorial, has repeated that. William Osler, who's one of the professors who helped to found the John Hopkins Hospital, he's been called the father of medicine, made the observation that soap and water and common sense are the most powerful disinfectants there are. And I hate to tell him, I didn't need a professor to tell me that, because my great-granny used to tell me that. My mama told me that. I've been saying that for as long as soap has been around. But now these days, you know, we live in a little different era. So when we talk about soap, we talk about, well, which soap should we use? That's because whenever we use soap to wash our hands or wash our bodies, like everything else in our modern culture today, we are faced with a plethora of choices. I always hate going and looking at, you remember when you would go and there were like two kinds of detergent, you know, And so your choices, now you got 5,000 different kinds of detergent. We've got a lot of choices. And I'm not talking about just whether we ought to use bar soap or liquid soap. We got things like chocolate soap, chocolate flavored soap. Now, I don't know how you know it's chocolate flavored, because you're not supposed to eat it. You're just supposed to wash with it. So I've never had quite figured that one out. We've got touch friendly soap. That is soap that has a texture so that you can get a pleasant sensory experience simply by just holding, you see, by manipulating the soap. And I don't know about you, but I don't take a shower so I can fondle the soap. And then you've got the 24-karat gold soap. That is formulated with little bitty particles of 24-karat gold in it. And they claim that that promotes suppleness and soft skin. It also probably has something to do with that soft head that made you go out and buy 24-karat soap in the first place. And then you've got natural soap, which emphasizes all those natural ingredients, you know, like the scent and the color and the shape, all those things. And then aromatherapy is supposed to give off an odor that makes you gives you a great sense of well-being. All these multi-sensory bar soaps are expanding, and they're giving us more the ability to give more value to our bath time. It's not just taking a bath, but it's cleansing, it's skin conditioning, it's improving, you see, our moods. Cleaning is what our text from Isaiah is about this morning. Because of the sins of the nation of Israel, God, through the prophet Isaiah, tells them, says, when you guys put on your next prayer performance, I like that, prayer performance, you know, when you put on your next preacher show, I'm going to be looking the other way, because it ain't going to make no difference how loud you pray or how long you pray or how often you pray. I ain't going to be listening. And you know why? Because you guys got blood on your hands. And then he follows that with the instruction, you need to go home, you need to wash it up, you need to clean up your act, sweep your life clean of your evil doing. Now, the sin that Isaiah is talking about here is that of being religious without being righteous. And I even hesitate to mention that, because that is fodder for another sermon. And if I get started on that, we'll be here like at Red Bank at 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. But that is a real issue. Because somewhere along the line we have gotten into our brains this idea that we can somehow be religious without being righteous. That we can claim, you see, all the benefits of being those who believe in God, and yet our actions in no way, ever indicate that we have any relationship with God whatsoever. The ones that tickle me are the folks that are spiritual but not religious. I go, what in God's name does that mean? Spiritual without being religious. Religious without being righteous. You see, in the text, through Isaiah, God is reporting that these people, they're very carefully observing, you see, all the religious practices. They go to every single festival that the church puts on. Every time the church doors are open, those folks are there. They never miss a sacrifice, but when it comes time, you see, for them to live out that kind of thing in their life, they're cheating widows and orphans. They're bribing the judges. When I was, I had a parish I was serving at one time, and a couple came to me, and they had a son that wanted to marry a girl who was a Jehovah's Witness and wanted me to go talk to him, because he wanted to become a Jehovah's Witness, and they wanted me to talk him out of it. So I went and I talked with him, and I talked while I was about blue in the face. And the young boy, at the end, I said, well, now, why is it you want to become a Jehovah's Witness? He said, I've been going to this church up here for about 30 years. And he said, every Sunday I see these folks come in here, and they say the creeds, and they say the Lord's Prayer, and they do all these righteous things, and then they go out Monday morning and they cheat and they lie and they steal and cheat on their wives and husbands. By the time he got through, I wanted to become a Jehovah's Witness too. But that's truth. That's being religious without being righteous. When we profess without actually living out. God says, learn to do good. Work for justice. Help the down and out. Stand up for the homeless. Go to bat for the defenseless. Then and only then, God says, will your worship, you see, have any value. None of your pious acts make any difference at all if there is no result. But the good news, as with all of God's prophecies, there is always an upside. Change is possible. And so God says, come, sit down, let's talk about this. And if your sins are blood red, they'll be made snow white. If they're red like crimson, they'll be like wool. You see, there is a kind of spiritual soap. Now, if I were going to boil this message down to about one sentence, which some folks probably think that's what I should have done to start with. If I was going to boil it down to one sentence, I suppose that overall lesson would be something like, don't do what's wrong, do what's right. Makes sense. But doing that, however, leaves us with a very important question. And that question is, why in the world do we have to be told that in the first place? I mean, take the people of Israel. As God's people, they had God's laws. They had the Ten Commandments. They knew all about the covenant between God and Israel. I mean, they had all that down. They had it pat. Surely they knew that what God wanted was for them to love the good, hate the evil, avoid doing what's wrong, do what's right, embrace righteousness, flee away from wickedness. So why in the world weren't they doing it? Well, we could ask the same question today. I mean, you've got to be pretty darn stupid to not know what's good and what's right. So why aren't we doing it? When we consciously do something wrong, usually it's not because we don't know any better, you see. I don't buy that. Rather, there is within each of us this spiritual duality that is always in conflict. And the trouble comes when we ignore that. Paul talks about that old nature, that new nature, when he talks to his churches. Kind of like that cartoon, you know, you see in the papers where, you know, you got the guy there and he's trying to make a decision, got a big question mark over the top of his head, and he's got a little devil on one shoulder, and that little devil's whispering in his ear, tell him one thing to do, and that angel is on the other side trying to tell him the right thing to do. And if you think that's probably too silly an image, then listen to what Paul has to say. He says, I don't understand my own actions. My own actions. I don't do the things I want to do. I do the stuff I hate. You see, Paul was aware that there is this inner conflict that is going on inside of each of us. It is a struggle that pulls us in diametrically opposed directions. When we were in high school, we learned about that German legendary alchemist, Faust. And remember, he sold his soul to the devil? And at one point, when he's wrestling with himself, he says, two souls, alas, are dwelling within me, and one is striving to forsake the other. Now, part of the problem is that very often when we deliberately do what's wrong, nothing bad happens to us. See? When we do that, then it becomes a whole lot easier for us to do that very same thing, or something worse, again. Now, I researched this and I went and looked at some psychological journals to try to get a grasp on why it is we humans do things like this. And this is what they say. First, we come up with our own rules for our behavior as a way to understand what we're doing. And then these individual behaviors become precedents for new rules. That means that bad behaviors are worth avoiding not because of their consequences, they're worth avoiding because of what they do to our own ideas about our behavior. And once we perceive ourselves as losing control in one arena, then we get less motivated in that arena. And finally, we engage in distorted informational processing in order to avoid the perception of having violated our own rules. And that makes us a less reliable guide to ourselves in time. Now, that's a whole lot of psychological hoodoo. And it means simply this. A, we make up our own rules. B, because of those rules, we lower our standards. C, decide that we're flawed and that it's okay to be flawed. And then we rationalize and make up excuses for why we do the things that we do. Those people that Isaiah was talking to, he was addressing a very similar problem. They were going through this very same sequence. They wanted the good graces of God, but they wanted to do that by coming up with their own rules. And we all do it at one time or another. Lord, if you'll just get me out of this bind that I'm in, then I'll quit smoking. Like somehow that matters to God whether you're smoking or not. Or I'll quit beating my wife, or I won't cuss anymore. You know, we try to bargain with God as if somehow we can manipulate that. We want to make up our own rules. God's going to be good to me because I did this, that, or the other. Now, when you get in the habit of doing that, then what that means is if you can justify doing that, you can justify doing just about anything. They justified their mistreating of other people by being pious in all the ways that they observed things in a religious way. And so the message that comes from God to Israel and down to us is a very simple one. And that is that God does not value ritual without reformation. You can talk all you want. My granddaddy used to say, sorry, don't feed the bulldog. Neither does talk. And that's one thing in our culture we have more of, that we've got a Lord's plenty of talk and got no doing, you say. Now, this failure to actually do the hard work of loving God, loving our neighbor, can be expressed in two new words I'm going to teach you this morning. And I apologize to my Baptist friends, but I'm going to share these with my Methodist brothers and sisters because I want them to have, you know, these are nice, long, good words you can use with your Baptist friends and they'll be impressed. Yes. And it makes you look good. Two words. One of those is orthodoxy. And the other is orthopraxis. Now, I'm going to explain those. Pay attention. Orthodoxy, you may already know, you probably studied that. It means believing the right thing. And that is very much involved in the rituals, even rituals that we observe, you see here on Sunday mornings. And is in Isaiah's day, folks made sure they never missed a religious holiday. They never missed any sacrifices. They were orthodox in all of their beliefs and all those rituals. And they illustrated those beliefs. Orthodoxy is a word that we are familiar with. We see it almost every Sunday in our worship. But orthopraxis, well, is that even a thing? You know, well, the answer is yes, it is. Because I looked it up and it's in the dictionary and it even has a Wikipedia article. So it must be a thing. Orthopraxis means right conduct. Unlike orthodoxy, which is all about what you believe, orthopraxis is about what you practice. Pleasing God, boys and girls, is not a matter of just orthodoxy alone. Believing what's right ain't going to get it if you don't do what's right. And that text from Isaiah reminds us that orthopraxis is crucial. You only have to look at Jesus' encounters with the Pharisees in the New Testament to see that. The Pharisees, bless their pointy little heads, they had orthodoxy coming out of their ears. But see, they were real poor on that orthopraxis side of things. And what did Jesus call all those that were strong on orthodoxy, weak on orthopraxis? What were they called? Repeat after me, hypocrites. Now, it might be a little fun if we go to Matthew chapter 15 about now and look at a story about Jesus encountering the Pharisees and their complaining that his disciples are eating without washing their hands. They had been in the field. They were eating grain from the field. And so they came to Jesus with the question, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before you eat. My granny would be proud. But Jesus replies, he says, and why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of tradition? For the sake of tradition, you make void the word of God. You hypocrites, and Isaiah prophesied rightly about you when he said, this people honors me with their lips, but their hearts, they're long way away from me. And so in vain do they worship, teaching human precepts as doctrines. Isaiah's theology of clean brings orthodoxy and orthopraxis together. Right belief with right doing. Ancient rites, including all those sacrifices of animals, the symbolic ritual cleanliness, by themselves, simply could not make anybody clean. In order for that to happen, they needed to do the right things, to be honest, to be just. Oh, mortal, you know what God desires. Fundamental to coming into the presence of God is living that life of obedience, one that makes you an advocate for justice, for mercy, compassionate acts, the like. Talking, brothers and sisters, is cheap. Now, a lot of interpreters of New Testament theology reduce spiritual cleansing down to the principle of, well, just come to Jesus and all is forgiven. You know, we make it as simple as that. You know, the once saved, always saved thing. We come to the altar that one time and then that kind of gives us a green light to be as nasty and rotten the rest of the time as we possibly can. Because all I got to do is just ask for forgiveness. And a part of that is true. That's true to a certain degree. But you see, that ain't the whole gospel. The Bible insists that good works have to follow faith. James wrote, so faith by itself, if there's no works, is dead. Now, you don't get any clearer than that. But somebody now is going to say, well, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I, by my works, will show you my faith. Now, those of us who identify as disciples, we work to do our best to do, put that word in emphasis, bold capital letters, to do the right thing, the moral thing, the loving thing as we seek to be in relationship with God and our neighbor. That is the soap, brothers and sisters, that washes us and makes us acceptable to God. I guess if I'm going to boil it down as this, it's not what you do in here that makes you acceptable to God, although I like it. It's what you do out there that makes you acceptable to God. Doing what is right, saying what is right, showing kindness and mercy, all those are the basic ingredients that go into making that spiritual soap, you see. There's no reason why we Christians can't live clean, think clean, be clean in our inner selves. And when we're clean this way, well, other folks are probably going to ask, well, what the secret is. And we can just tell them at that point, well, you know, the secret is in the soap. Let us pray. Now, Lord, there are times when our hearts ache and our souls wander and we're full of doubts. Even so, maybe even especially so, we turn to you in prayer. We see the news flashed across the TV of droughts and hunger, and we read online of unprovoked attacks on the innocent. We mourn all those tragic losses. We pray for those who have survived. We see bold headlines of heinous crimes and scandals that grab our attention and makes us wonder where you are in all this. In the stillness, sometimes we only hear the serenity of silence and the sense that you can handle our doubts and our misgivings. I mean, after all, when everything else fails, you are still God. In the meantime, we can hear the assurance of your loving voice that says, "Be still and know that I am God." And so in a leap of faith, we listen, we pray, and we hope. In Jesus' name, amen. My children, may God bless you with discomfort at easy answers and half-truths and superficial relationships. May God grant you anger at injustice and oppression and exploitation. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer. And may God bless you with just enough foolishness to believe that you can actually make a difference in this world so that you can do things that nobody else can do. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.